I think I could fairly easily support that Satan's strategies to do Christians harm are heavily, if not predominantly, focused on the Christian's mind, on what we think, on how we think, what we believe, and then what we react to in our thinking process. And I think there's two areas he really hones in on with believers. The first area is God's approval of us. And the second area would be what lies in the future for us. In the first area, God's approval, we have to realize God's grace has accepted our faith in Jesus Christ for salvation from our sins. That love cannot, will not be broken. He sees Christ's righteousness in us, and he approves of us always. Now, he allows consequences for sin, but there's no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. Parents can reject us, friends can reject us, family can reject us, peers can reject us, even culture as a whole can reject or betray or abandon or persecute us. But God loves us, he's adopted us, he's promised to complete in us what he began in our salvation. The second area we struggle with is, what is our destiny? What does our future look like? Do we need to fear it? Do we need to fear death? Will our enemies prevail over us and have their way? Are believers going to experience God's judgment? Am I in good standing with God or not good standing? Am I going through the tribulation or not going through the tribulation? And then we're aware that our deeds, even though even our most righteous ones, deserve death in judgment and God's wrath. So will church apostasy doom us as well? Will evil leaders destroy us? Is there a rapture? Is there such a thing? And if so, when? I'm glad you're asking and questioning these things. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5 is where we are. Let's take a look at apostasy, the rapture, and the man of lawlessness. Paul says, "Now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to be easily upset or troubled, either by a prophecy or a message or by a letter supposedly from us, alleging that the day of the Lord has come. Don't let anyone deceive you in that way. For that day will not come unless the apostasy comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. He opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship so that he sits in God's temple proclaiming that he himself is God. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you about this?" So I want you to notice first the misunderstanding. What is he addressing? What are they dealing with? Humanity lives in a natural fear. All of us struggle with a subconscious fear of being betrayed or abandoned. And the apostle wrote this section of our letter to deal with the loss of hope. They had lost their hope and their joy, their confidence, because of a fear of evil in the end times and where they stood with God. Paul had given them instructions. Remember, this is a very, very young, brand new church. And he had distinguished that the rapture was something the prophets didn't fully understand. The rapture, the taking out of the church in this age, is a different event in 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, than the day of the Lord that the prophets had spoke of and taught them about. The day of the Lord included God's judgment, and the Lord's judgment, a Messiah's judgment on an unbelieving world, and then his establishment of the kingdom. That's why Israel was so confused when Jesus came. He didn't judge the Romans and all the evil people, and he didn't immediately establish his throne. But he said, "I've come not to condemn the world, but to save it. This is not the day of the Lord." It was his first advent. And so only a few months later, after he addresses that, And I really believe 1 Thessalonians 4 and 5 in understanding the distinguishing of a rapture that was previously unknown from the day of the Lord, where the Lord would literally come down to earth and fight on behalf of Israel. I think that is the key. Because the rapture is in chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians. And the day of the Lord then, he says, now concerning these times and events in the day of the Lord. That is absolutely key to understanding, I think, this section. And so they've been drawn back into a fear. And Paul had made very clear to them in 1 Thessalonians 5, 4 through 9, that they couldn't be in the day of the Lord because it was clearly the day of the Lord was for unbelievers. It was not for his church. In fact, look back there. Let's just reaffirm that again. The day of the Lord, the coming of God back down on earth, Jesus, to fight on behalf of Israel, to defeat the enemies of God, and then establish the throne. But look at 1 Thessalonians 5, 4 through 9. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in the dark for this day to surprise you like a thief. For you're all children of light and children of the day. We don't belong to the night or the darkness. So then, let us not sleep like the rest, but let us stay awake and be self-controlled. For those who sleep at night. Those who get drunk, they get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled and put on the armor of faith and love and a helmet of the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so he's assured them of that. So look on your outline. Christians are not to grieve death like the rest who have no hope, but rather encourage one another with an anticipation of the rapture, their blessed hope. That's in 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 17. Now look on the screen at Titus 2, 13. Another New Testament passage, I think, goes hand in hand with this. We wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, with that in mind, I want to read verse 1 again in 2 Thessalonians 2. Now, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, and he says, don't be so easily upset. I want you to understand that the Greek syntax in verse 1 uses one article for the two nouns. That means it's connecting them. Look on the screen in your outline. Verse 1 connects the coming and being gathered to him as the same event. If the coming and being gathered to him are the same event, if both of those nouns are connected to one event, then that's the rapture, clearly, Christ's coming. His parousia is mentioned here for the seventh time in these two letters. And Paul associates his coming in the sky. He comes down, but we're caught out. His second coming clearly indicates he will come down to earth with his army behind him and he will fight. There are two different events. So he says he'll come down to rapture, to gather us, to snatch us out unexpectedly off of this earth. Now look at the next point. By convincing the believers that the day of the Lord had come, false teachers created a storm that shook them from their normal sound mind, reason, and composure into emotional fear and agitation. I don't think the words are strong enough at the end of verse 1 and verse 2. Look at them again. We ask you, brothers and sisters, not to be easily upset or troubled either by prophecy or by a message or by a letter supposedly from us alleging that the day of the Lord has come. The false teachers that were sending these things had the marks of a true speaker of God. They proclaimed divine revelation. They proclamated and proclaimed his teachings and authority, and they were said they were receiving those from the apostles. But the translation here, where I think it's too soft, this is a translation that literally is a word that is so strong, it means to be shaken by a storm. or it's to literally be tottering in the middle of an earthquake. It's to be shaken to your very core, taken off of your feet, knocked around, tottering on the edge of a feeling of destruction. Isn't that what Satan does in our mind? You ever woke up at 2 or 3 o'clock and said, it's over. Everything's over. And the room is dark and your mind is shaken to the core. You say, it's over. I'm going down. I can't come out of this one. I'm not going to survive this one here. This one's too deep. It's too dark. I've been too hurt. I'm too wounded. I can't move on. That's where they were at. They were absolutely shaken off their feet. Just a dread. The word means literally something that is like a twig in a twister. That's what they felt like, just bent and broken and thrown around. Do you have irrational fears or anxieties or dreads? Before you go and get medication, start first with trying to tear down those strongholds in your mind and your thinking. Because a lot of times that thinking is creating the problem. The thinking creates the dread and the fear and the anxiety, which then triggers your body, which then begins to react to that constant dread and fear and anxiety and the chemicals going on there. And so start there, because we need to replace those fears with the grace of God, the love of God, the unconditional acceptance of God, Him telling us, comfort one another. When Christ comes, it's not for your bad, it's for your good. And then He goes on to say there are two things that will come before that tribulation period comes: the judgment of God in the day of the Lord, and then His establishing the kingdom. Look at the next point in your outline. Two dreadful things that precede the coming of the Lord. Look at 3b through verse 5. At the end of verse 3, he says, for that day will not come unless the apostasy comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed. The man doomed to destruction, he opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God or object of worship, so that he sits in God's temple proclaiming that he himself is God. Don't you remember when I was with you, I used to tell you these things. The day of the Lord, God's judgment on unbelievers followed by Christ's reign and kingdom won't come until two things happen. Number one, he says the apostasy comes first. First comes the apostasy. Apostasy is a word that can kind of move in so many directions. It has so many different ways to describe it. It's a word that can mean a revolt, which is strong, or a little a rebellion. But it can be a softer word, like a falling or drifting away, or a departure. So people take apostasy, and it's described in a lot of different ways. Some have even said, since the apostasy means a departure, we're going to take that and say this is further evidence that the church will depart, the apostasy, the departure of the church will come first, and then the man of lawlessness. I think there's some holes in trying to use that word that way. I think that's too strong. I think the broader meaning of the word in a revolt, a rebellion, a departure, I think leads you in a different way. So you'll hear it. If you pick up five commentaries, they'll take one of the meanings of the word and tend to kind of go. But in studying deeply, I think you can find kind of a common universal agreement with what's involved and what it means. And that's what I put down for you. When you think of the apostasy coming, it's a cultural and spiritual departure from or positioning oneself away from. So does it involve a revolt or rebellion? You bet. The 60s, when they began to depart, to move away from some of the traditional values of family and marriage and sexuality, was there a revolt? Absolutely. Was it a departure from the established ways? Absolutely. Was it a falling away? Absolutely. And it's a falling away from the faith. And what do we mean by faith? Well, faith is by salvation through grace. And churches have fallen so far away, a lot of people aren't even teaching the gospel. You'd be amazed how many people come from being in church for years and sit down with their staff and say, I've never heard the gospel explained. I've never heard it defined biblically and explained that way. By faith, we're talking about the fact that the Bible is infallible and inerrant. You can't pick what parts of it are real and what parts don't really mean that. And that's for why I, as a dispensationalist, it's part of the reason I take that philosophy. It tries to interpret the scripture, all the scripture, as literally as you can. A falling away from God's laws that supersede all laws of man. God never becomes too old-fashioned that his laws don't work anymore. And by faith, we're talking about obedience to Christ. It's expected. So the apostasy is the loosening, the easing, a progressive replacement, a questioning of Christ, his word, his church, and the authority, therefore, in life. Isn't that what churches are full of? Maybe you would find some of that is snuck into your life. I just don't buy the hard line teaching that our church does in some ways. Tries to take everything so literally, and you can't take it that way. It just doesn't mean that. It doesn't fit. We're not like that anymore. Well, that's an apostasy. It's a moving away from traditional values, Christian doctrines, and those kind of things. Now, there's generally one group associated with doing this, but I think it's very clear you can see two groups. So look at the two groups that I think we'll see an apostasy coming into before the day of the Lord. The first one is a falling away from Christians, from Christ and his commands. This is even our increasing number of preachers who say, I don't believe in a literal hell. They share a perverted gospel. Man-seeking rather than Christ-focused church. Someone taught, Alistair Begg, who's a wonderful teacher, he advised, he says, somewhere for everyone, but they asked if you should go to a wedding of a family member who's marrying a homosexual, and he said, do they know where you stand? And they said, yes, and he said, in my opinion, I think you could. That's not apostasy, but we are on such a witch hunt today. Radio station took them totally off. They said there's only one stand. And on those areas, folks, there's not one stand. The main thing is the main thing. But if you have a gift of mercy, you will share God's truth from a viewpoint of his mercy in the midst of his standard. If you have my gift of teaching and exhortation, you will teach the standard as the only way to really, truly love. We're just different. What I'm talking about apostasy is I'm talking of falling away entirely. It's the Christian who says, I don't care what you say there. The Bible doesn't mean that. There is no sin in homosexuality. There is no sin in abortion. And you cannot possibly justify yourself spiritually that way, and you won't before the Lord Jesus. And so we don't hesitate to just say it real clear. It can be areas like marriage or gender or sanctity of life. And so the church begins to fall away. You would be horrified if you just started visiting a bunch of churches in town and you've been here a while at how many churches you walk in will never open the Word of God once. They'll start talking. They'll give a nice little speech. They might quote a verse somewhere in the middle of it, but they're not teaching Christ. They're not teaching through the scriptures with it as the top. Now, there's a second group that I think you can see this happening to, too, and that's the Jews, God's people. They're a nation founded and centered in the Mosaic laws and covenants and sacrificial system. If you were to talk to most Jews today, they've departed totally from Judaism. They don't follow the laws of God. Most of them say there is no Messiah coming. I don't buy that at all. And they can be some of the most pagan, liberal-minded people on the planet Earth. They've departed. Their apostasy is further along, some of them, against the Judean concepts of God than the church. Maybe is sometimes with Christ's commands. I think that's part of what God's going to do right now. I think, through the hardship, they will begin returning to God, and they'll begin crying out for God. Then when they cry out for God and begin to look at the scriptures again in the Old Testament, they'll begin to think about what about a Messiah? And then they'll have to deal with, was Jesus the Messiah? And that's what I think you'll do. So the apostasy comes first, and then notice the second thing. The man of lawlessness is declared publicly. That's the next thing that'll happen before judgment. Human history has had its share of evil leaders, hasn't it? It's had the emperors everywhere from the Nero of Paul's day to the Domitian of John's later days. We've had the Stalins, we've had the Hitlers. Even religious history has been plagued by false Christs, false teachers, cult leaders, innumerable wolves dressed in lamb's clothing. But one is coming who will surpass all of them. His goal will be not to lead any of the people, but to be worshiped by all people. He will want the worship of God, which was exactly what Satan wanted in heaven. And his evil will surpass all antichrists that we've ever seen, false teachers. The extent of his power will be broader, and he'll have more power than any have ever had. Now, note his character next. This man is a law unto himself, despising God's laws and making his own. He's called many names in the Bible. This person is the Gog in the land of Magog. This is the prince of Rosh, Meshach, and Tubal in Ezekiel 38. He's the little horn and prince who is to come. He's the king who does as he pleases in Daniel. He's the foolish, worthless shepherd in Zechariah 11, 15 to 17. He's the beast in Revelation. But what's his greatest title? He's the great Antichrist. And though there have been many Antichrists, I attempted to show you all summer long how the Antichrists have risen worldwide, and beginning in the 1960s especially, began to implement this last age in a way that has affected the whole world. I went back and listened to someone, a rather lengthy message this week that takes it back to the 1920s, and it is sobering. And I thought, it's 1920s, goes back that early. Have you ever woke up and said, how did our pulpits, how did our science, how did our education, how did I look up one day and all of it be in line with this woke agenda and anti-God stance? How did that happen? Where was I when all this was? And all of a sudden I look up one day in the news media, only 3% of our entire news media claim to be conservative. 3%. What happened? I'll tell you what happened. The Antichrist began rising up quietly and setting in place the liberal, godless policies that the great Antichrist will walk into and be set up to take over. He'll rule all. He'll oppose everything halfway through the tribulation. He'll do away with Israel's sacrifices and say, I am God. Look at the next point. What about his identity? Who is he? His identity has been unknown, and it's hidden. It remains hidden until the right time when he will suddenly be brought into power. Is he alive today? I don't know. I would bet he is. Have things been getting worse? Oh, yeah. And people say, well, you guys, people like you, Craig, you've been saying things are going to get worse forever. And I say, yep, that's true. Everything I said when I was 20 is happening now, because the scripture said it back when I was 20 years old. But it's happening so fast the last 2 or 3 years, every person will say, I never dreamed in my life I would see that and that and that and that and that and that and that. How did it happen? Well, that's what we're dealing with. So let's read verses 1 through 5 one more time, and then I want to lead us into a response time. Now, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, one event, the rapture. We ask you, brothers and sisters, not to be easily upset or troubled, either by prophecy or a message or by a letter supposedly from us alleging that the day of the Lord has come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for the day will not come unless the apostasy comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. He opposes, he exalts himself above every so-called God or every object of worship so that he sits even in God's temple, proclaiming that he himself is God. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you or teach you these things? So let me ask the question. Not one scripture. People sometimes say, hey, look at the next screen. It's been declared that there's not one verse of scripture where it explicitly affirms the rapture of the church before the tribulation. There's not one verse of scripture that explicitly affirms the rapture of the church before scripture. Notice my response. True. That's true. However, let's look at a few things. Number one, Paul, in speaking of the future, never says one word to prepare the saints for the horror of tribulation. Every time Paul speaks of the future, he never says one word to the church about how to prepare for the horrors of the tribulation. Surely, as shaken and terrified as they had become about going through this, Paul would have done so if they were to be caught up with Christ after post-millennialism, the enduring of God's wrath on the day of our Lord. Now, when something is never said in Scripture, you can't build a whole doctrine around it because that's assumption. When something is said explicitly in Scripture, you can build doctrine on it. You can't say, well, I never find that, and say, therefore, I can build doctrine because I never found that. And that is true. But this statement is strengthened when you add it to a few other statements. This is an assumption, granted. But look at the next statement. When Jesus, when preaching to the Jewish majority who had rejected him, or rejected John the Baptist's message of repentance and salvation in Jesus as Messiah, he said much to that group about the coming wrath and tribulation, but not one word about their being caught up to meet him in the air through the adherence to the Mosaic law and sacrificial system. Now, when you put both those back to back, and this one, it is explicit. When you say he never prepared his saints, his church, the church age, the believers in Christ Jesus for the tribulation, but everything he was saying to the Jews who were rejecting him, and he kept telling them when he addressed the coming day of the Lord, he did speak to them. He said a lot about God's wrath and tribulation coming. He never mentioned a word to them about being caught up out of it. Well, that makes you start to think. Okay, those Jews, most of them who had rejected John the Baptist's message, what was John the Baptist's message? Repent and prepare, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. One has come who I'm not even worthy to tie his sandal. He's here, is what he's saying. Repent and get ready for him. And so the church and the rapture are distinguished again from the Jews and the day of the Lord and judgment. Look at the next point. The distinct hope of the body of Christ, which was Paul's message in their first letter and where we began today, is the rapture of the believers to be with Jesus. Listen, tear down those strongholds of fear that rob you of God's freedom. Tear down the strongholds of fear that rob you of his joy, his peace. Nothing separates us from the love of God. We're not appointed to God's wrath. We are not appointed to go through that, but Christ's deliverance. So what's our response? Look on the screen. Live and respond daily to God's grace. His grace in salvation, his grace that is for today, no matter what we're going through, and his grace for what is destined for our future. Look at Titus 2, 11 through 14. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people. instructing us to deny godlessness and worldly lusts and to live in a sensible, righteous, and godly way in the present age while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. He gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to cleanse for himself a people for his own possession, eager to do good works. He saved us by grace. His grace is sufficient for today. His grace will ultimately result in a salvation through justification and sanctification, all the way up to a salvation coming that will be through glorification. His return is our blessed hope and motivation for doing good works. Look at a second response we can have today. Christians are not to fear physical death and God's judgment. The prophesied day of the Lord, which begins with his great tribulation judgment on the unbelieving world, is for those who've suppressed God's truth, ignored God's revelation, and perverted God's glory. You remember us covering that? That's who the wrath is for. Quit letting thoughts and questions whether God accepts you or loves you or will work with you or his grace is sufficient for your sin or that he sees the righteousness of Christ in you instead of your weakness and your frailty. A healthy believer acknowledges two things. I am depraved. I'm never going to get it right. I'm a mess. And I can externally impress man, but internally I know my thoughts. And when I work on this, then I start failing in this. And when I try to work on this discipline, then this one starts sliding. And when I try to hold firm to the Word of God, I become judgmental of everybody else. And then when I try to hold firm to grace, I become willing to just let sin happen and just God's grace is sufficient for it. You deal with that? I do. But that shouldn't lead us to be shaken. We're a mess. The second part of being a healthy Christian is acknowledging the need, though we're a mess, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ. He approves of us. He loves us. Now live in a manner that way. Don't live out of fear that you got to stack up. Live out of the joy and the grateful heart that he loves us unconditionally. Number three, Christians are to, third way to respond, we are to live righteously and encourage one another with an anticipation and confidence of Christ coming to rapture the church, both the living and the dead, out of this world before its judgment. He'll snatch us out to be with him in his Father's house. We'll become like him, glorification, seeing him as he is. Therefore, our blessed hope in this grace and eagerly anticipated coming for us should lead us to purify ourselves daily, just as he is pure. And I'm going to end by reading 1 John 2:28 through 3:3. So now, little children, remain in him so that when he appears, we'll have confidence. We won't be ashamed before his coming, before him at his coming. If you know that he's righteous, you know this as well. Everyone who's born does what is right has been born of him. See what great love the Father has given us that we should be called God's children, and we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it didn't know him. Dear friends, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not even yet been revealed. We know that when he appears, we'll be like him because we'll see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. Why am I purifying? Why am I working so hard on sanctification? When Jesus comes to get me and pull me out, I don't want to be ashamed and say, I wasn't living fully for you, Lord. I wasn't ready. I want to say, listen, being pulled out means I'm going to see you face to face as you are in your holiness and your purity. I'm going to be glorified and understand that this battle with sin is behind me. But I don't want to be ashamed. I want to be pure and be ready for you. I want to live in a right way, not because your wrath's going to be poured out, but because I'm going to see Jesus face to face. What does a child or grandchild who loves their parent or grandparent do when they're wrong? They're ashamed. They don't want to look up at you. They don't want to respond. They try to hide. They're ashamed. And what do? You pull them in and say, I love you. But let's not do that. It's not who we are. We just don't do that. Will you bow your heads, close your eyes this morning? And will you ask God how these words fit in your life? I'm going to ask leaders to go over to the sides. At the side of our worship center, you'll see the cross and you'll see the water fountain. You can go over there and a leader will pray for you, with you. You can ask them questions about salvation. But you take a few minutes to apply what God has shown you this morning. Heavenly Father, we can see the seasons where apostasy affected the Jewish people, your people. We can see the consequences of that. We can see your never-ending love toward it as well. When we read the book of Acts, we see a church that's right. And we can see in our day a remnant that is pure and holy and seeking you, but for the most part, we see an apostasy spreading quickly. An embracing of that which has never been truly your doctrine, your command, your ways, your salvation, your faith. So help us to stay strong in you. Help us to encourage one another constantly in the fact that in the blinking of an eye, Christ's going to snatch us out of here. And we'll see him face to face, be glorified, and we'll see him as he is. And we don't want to be ashamed at that moment. We don't want to look down. We want to be, oh, I've been waiting for you and doing everything I could for you. You're here. So help us to take that stand and to purify ourselves as Christ himself is pure. Comfort us in these words. Help us to live in the joy and the peace and the abundance of our blessed hope. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.